Hey, I'm Michael Hoff with Digital Theologian, and welcome to day 20 of 40 Days with Jesus. We're halfway there. Can you believe it? We are given a ton of details about where Jesus is as he starts speaking here in 10:22. We're told that it is winter, that it's the Feast of Dedication, aka Hanukkah, and that Jesus is in Jerusalem in the temple at Solomon's Colonnade. So that gives us a ton of information to know what is happening here, and that paints the backdrop of what we've already seen in the beginning of chapter 10. Jesus is already making claims about the leadership of the nation of Israel. We saw it yesterday as he was discussing being the good shepherd, and all of those images of shepherding and leadership coming together during the Feast of Hanukkah. It was that time when the nation of Israel was remembering Judas Maccabee and the dedication of the temple, and really the only reason that any of that was necessary was because the leadership of the nation had failed previously, allowed the Greeks in, and ultimately that led to a pig being sacrificed on the altar in Jerusalem. And so there had been a major failure of the shepherds of the people. Judas Maccabee helped restore that, and now there are some questions again about the leadership of the country. And so the people are saying to Jesus, "Will you plainly tell us that you are the Messiah? We're here, it's winter. It's the Feast of Dedication. It's Hanukkah. This is the time that we remember that Judas Maccabee, aka the Hammer, stepped up to lead a revolt against the people who were oppressing us. Well, now the Greeks are gone, but the Romans are here. And you, Jesus, are you the Messiah to step up like Judas Maccabee and help us crush our enemies?" There were very clear connotations to someone standing up in Jerusalem during the Feast of Dedication and claiming that they are the Messiah. This would be yet another feast that Jesus would fulfill. But the people want to hear Jesus say from his mouth simply, "Are you the Messiah?" Jesus refuses to give them a straight answer. He says, "Look, I've already told you. My Father's works that I do speak for me." And so Jesus is saying, "Look, I've told you, the works are declaring it. If you don't believe them, you won't believe it. You're not my sheep if you don't already believe what I've done." Again, Jesus emphasizes that his sheep will hear his voice. And again, we're given the promise that we who believe in Jesus will have eternal life. This isn't the first time that Jesus makes this claim, and it's not the last. Jesus has consistently, in the midst of doing works that demonstrate that he is the Son of God, that he is the one who is equal with the Father, he makes the statement that those who follow him will have eternal life. I find it so comforting that Jesus says that those that belong to him, the Father holds, and that no one can snatch them from his hand. Jim Elliot, who was one of five missionaries that was killed while trying to reach out to the Akua Indians in Ecuador, said that the safest place that you could be was in the center of God's will. You might be thinking, well, Michael, you may not have noticed, but you opened that by saying that Jim was killed. So how could the safest place be the center of God's will? Did he step outside of God's will? What was going on there? Well, Jim gave his life so that that group of people could come to know Jesus. And through his death and the further missionary efforts of Jim's family and the families of those who were lost, they led the entire tribe of the Akua Indians to know Jesus. And it was such a demonstrative turnaround that the children of the missionaries who were killed became friends with and then would travel and share the gospel with the very ones who killed their parents. That is the redeeming work of the power of the cross. And Jesus comes in and he says, "Look, no one can take away the life of those that are given to my Father." But Jesus himself is willing to lay down his life. He's already said that previously in chapter 10, that the good shepherd is willing to lay down his life for the sheep. And now we're seeing here that Jesus is continuing to say that those who follow him will have eternal life, and that no one can snatch that life away from the Father who holds it. In the midst of turbulent times, we can hang on to the truth of who Jesus is and what he has said, and we can know that we are anchored in the Father, and that no one, nothing, can take us out of his hand. You know, Paul says it so well in Romans 8, that there is truly nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Height, depth, future, past, principalities, powers, there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. It doesn't matter. When God holds us, nothing can take us away from him. So I want to encourage you to hang on to the Lord in the midst of everything that's going on. Trust in Jesus as the shepherd. Follow him. Let the works that Jesus did speak for themselves. And my hope is that as we've been reading along here in John, that you're seeing that Jesus began by testifying who he was and what he was saying. You know, with the temple cleansing, before the woman at the well, with the blind man, there have been a number of times where Jesus has clearly said who he is and what he's about. And now, as the people are demanding a clear sign, Jesus refuses to give it to them, because the works that he's done, the signs that he's performed, speak for themselves. So when Jesus says that he and the Father are one, the Jews pick up stones to kill him. Jesus' time is not yet, but we've seen the building pressure for the people to kill Jesus. As we come to the close of chapter 10, Jesus has made his case. It has been identified. He has refused to say things more clearly, but yet he unpacks everything that we've seen from the beginning of John up until now. He unpacks it one more time in that final dialogue, and then he leaves Jerusalem and returns to the place where he started his ministry, where John the Baptist was baptizing. And it said then that John the Baptist had done no signs. We've been told Jesus has done several. But John the Baptist has done no signs, but he testified about Jesus, and everything that John said about Jesus was true. The Jews are irate because Jesus supposedly was testifying about himself. But now, as he's making his closing arguments, he appeals to his works, and they themselves point to the testimony of John the Baptist, that everything John said about Jesus was true, and the result is that many believe in Jesus. And it is my hope that we as the people of God, that we as Christians would be those who are true to Jesus, that we would make true testimony, and that the testimony of our lives would be something that shines like a beacon in the night, that we would be a people of hope, a people of courage, a people of life, and that we would be those that can rally others, whether they can believe our testimony initially or not. No matter what happens to us, that they would be able to circle back around and say, you know what? I didn't really believe initially, but I've seen that everything that they said about Jesus was true, and that they would come to know Jesus as a result of our testimony. Anybody who calls themselves a follower of Jesus has acknowledged, man, somewhere along the way, we have missed the mark, and now we come home to a Father who loves us. And while we aren't perfect, we know that God is good and that he has forgiven us. I'm so thankful for all of you who are watching these videos. May you have an amazing day, and I'll see you in the next one.